If this room is full of darkness for thousands of years, and you come in and begin to weep and wail, oh, the darkness, will the darkness vanish? Strike a match, and light comes in a moment. What good will it do you to think all your lives, oh, I have done evil, I have made many mistakes? It requires no ghost to tell us that. Bring in the light, and the evil goes in a moment. Build up your character, and manifest your real nature, the effulgent, the resplendent, the ever pure, and call it up in everyone that you see. I wish that every one of us had come to such a state that even in the vilest of human beings, we could see the real self within, and instead of condemning them, say, "Rise, thou effulgent one, rise, thou who art always pure, rise, thou birthless and deathless, rise, almighty, and manifest thy true nature. These little manifestations do not befit thee." This is the highest prayer that the Advaita teaches. This is the one prayer to remember our true nature, the God who is always within us, thinking of it always as infinite, almighty, ever good, ever beneficent, selfless, bereft of all limitations. And because that nature is selfless, it is strong and fearless, for only to selfishness comes fear. He who has nothing to desire for himself, whom does he fear? And what can frighten him? What fear has death for him? What fear has evil for him? So if we are Advaitists, we must think from this moment that our old self is dead and gone. The old Mr., Mrs., and Miss. so-and-so are gone. They were mere superstitions. And what remains is the ever-pure, the ever-strong, the almighty, the all-knowing. That alone remains for us. And then all fear vanishes from us. Who can injure us, the omnipresent? All weakness has vanished from us. And our only work is to arouse this knowledge in our fellow beings. We see that they too are the same pure self, only they do not know it. We must teach them. We must help them to rouse up their infinite nature. This is what I feel to be absolutely necessary all over the world. These doctrines are old, older than many mountains possibly. All truth is eternal. Truth is nobody's property. No race, no individual can lay any exclusive claim to it. Truth is the nature of all souls. Who can lay any special claim to it? But it has to be made practical, to be made simple, for the highest truths are always simple, so that it may penetrate every pore of human society and become the property of the highest intellects and the commonest minds of the man, woman and child at the same time. All these ratiocinations of logic, all these bundles of metaphysics, all these theologies and ceremonies may have been good in their own time, but let us try to make things simpler and bring about the golden days when every man will be a worshipper and the reality in every man will be the object of worship.